see, no one can talk about the work better than the artist. From the gallery side, I think it's just important to say that, you know, we're so extremely proud to work with Johan, and I think Johan is kind of a metaphor in this example for working with artists who in some way are touching on very important subjects, and the story is not always being told as publicly as it could be, and probably because you spend the better part of your career helping young artists develop and working in such a collaborative way that sometimes you get a little bit lost in that. And I think that's the important thing about this show, is it's all your elements, ideas that he's been working with for a long period of time. He hasn't had an exhibition in a number of years, a solo exhibition. And I think that's why this is such a momentous show and a great occasion to celebrate. So, well done.
Thank you very much, Jan. I think it is important to say that, you know, we've certainly worked together over the years in many different guises and so on, and known each other for quite a long time, but it is important. I mean, a show like this can't really exist without the support of galleries who are willing to say, we might lose some money on this and we have some sleepless nights. But they feel it's important. And I think that that is one of the things that often gets missing in South African art these days, is there's just so much money around us, and it is such a struggle to stay alive. And our museums well, you know, unfortunately, most of them are in a state of complete disrepair, you know, so that kind of proving grounds for young artists and even older artists like myself who do not work necessarily commercially, you know, those proving grounds are become incredibly difficult to find in this country. And I also think that a lot of young artists just look at the art world and they think it's easy to make money, you do it through the gram, you do it through Facebook, you do it however that is, you know, this other kind of new world economy. But if you don't have that experience of setting up hundreds of shows, and you know, I know I certainly have, and I know you guys certainly have, and I think there's something that goes missing, not only in terms of the logistics of the thing, but also in terms of the question of why it is that you would go through all this trouble to begin with. There are easier ways to make money. That's it. There are easier ways to become famous than trying to be a good artist, for lack of a better term. So, you know, it's really great for me to have a solo show of works that I've been thinking about for a long time. And I'm going to try and take you with on that journey today and give you an idea or an inkling of how a longer process then kind of unfolds into a show like this, which I think is not a gigantic show, but it's an incredibly focused show. Many other works of art have appeared along the way throughout the years of conceptualizing this show. And they do their own thing and they continue it. But then somewhere in the middle, this thing holds. And it unfolds and things happen to you. And things happen around you. And they kind of all become part of a stream of consciousness that informs this particular moment. So I'm very happy to have all this work here. Exactly as I imagine, despite all the obstacles and the difficulties inherent in actually getting that right. And to be able to have that kind of single moment of materialization of thought and idea within a gallery space, but also that kind of a vibration of energy that can only happen when you feel like the works all talk to one another sensibly. So, for the walkabout today, I thought it has a decidedly performative element to it. I've been doing a lot of readings and working with a lot of different voices. So, before I start today, I want to then kind of lay out some groundwork. I'm going to take you along in the making and the production of this work. I will be utilizing a number of different voices, and sometimes you'll know who's speaking, sometimes perhaps not. But I do know that at least one of those voices is analytical. It looks at the work, and I will try and inform you about the production of the work, how the thing's made. One of them, I think, is more poetic and open-ended, and it will take you to other places, the kinds of call it life experiences and thoughts that inform the work, and these are, of course, highly subjective and personal. And then, of course, here and then we'll turn to another voice, and that voice reaches out from the darkness and is a kind of unseen presence within the show that keeps it together, and bring it momentarily back into the light. And if there are moments of hesitation, it's because it takes some kind of mental space to jump between these voices. You need breath in between them. It's a strange metaphor, breath. You need to be able to breathe in between these different utterances. So I have, at odd moments in my life, been very close to it. I can at least recall once in my life that I was so sick that I wished for it. I have seen many of my fellow travelers on this planet exit. And though it fills you with sadness, and that part of the journey is obviously unavoidable and it's great loss, I take it as a natural part of life. There's nothing in the act of dying that petrifies me. I'm not religious, and so I don't foresee waking up somewhere else with pretty flowers and popping a bell. This is not part of my framework, nor do I think that notions of absolute good and evil exist and await somewhere else to judge the things that I do. I think that throughout my work and life as an artist, I have reached a point where I'm perfectly willing to accept my own small place within this world. And the great natural world around us, the fantastic unfolding of life and events that takes place, that we might be very happy to say that we are part of and that we are aware of. This for me is a great thing. I think the fact that we can think about these things means that we can think about meaning, and that we are uniquely poised to do so within this entire kind of thing that we call life. So on that level, the show is not about fear. It is, if anything, about memory. Time. And of a kind of a building forward. So these things figurate within the show, of course, on the one hand, part of the skull, which reminds us of the cycle of life. Things are what they are, and fall. And that's perhaps a kind of symbolic thing. It's a visual element that we understand. We understand that it means death. It reminds us of that, as the old idea of memento mori would suggest. But the brick tells us another story. Apart from being able to throw it through a window, as one of our older South African artists, or the previous generation of artists once done, this thing is a constant presence in our lives, in this space, in the new. It is in the absence of bricks and soil, it's through the absence of brick and soil in London that I first realized how deeply ingrained a sense of the material is to me. I come from South Africa, this developing place, where sure it's chaos, it's no one seems to be in control, perhaps even more so today than any other time before, but you could always find large piles of soil on the streets, the neighborhoods, a stack of bricks here and there. These things serve as a kind of optimism. We are building something. Something is happening. So between the inevitable passing of time, that's that kind of rigid, almost linear concept of it. We have this fighting, this building. It says, we understand this thing is happening, but we will build regardless. Even against that force, this thing of building takes place. So, I think for many Europeans who come to South Africa specifically, they don't understand time here. It doesn't operate in a linear fashion. It is not like there's a clear-cut notion of history that holds the thing together. Instead, we have so many things happening simultaneously within this space that that death and life emerge as constant counterparts, even friends, forces that animate each other and that continue. But a skull is not just a skull, and the death of a person is not just the death of any other person. You can't simply substitute one for the other, because that would fundamentally undermine the question of why the thing is meaningful to begin with. So, this skull specifically, that's a car skull, of course, it's not the real thing. But I was given this skull by someone else, and it has a dark history, in as much as the person whose skull that was an unidentified homicide victim. So it's a cult. There's no line to memory that keeps that person in the light. They are one of countless creatures in this particular place who just appeared and disappeared without any memory, without any respectful gesture of the value of what that life was, could have been. It's just missing. And so it was deeply problematic for me to have taken some sort of ownership, even if temporarily, over the skull, because it filled me with that sense of ethics, of dread. So I left the thing alone for a long time. I kept it hidden, as it were. Said, I now have this thing, I've always wanted one for whatever reason. But it is a problem. And it's not a problem to which there are any answers. So it took a long time for the skull to see the light, to be reanimated within this particular body of work as something that I hope is hopeful and on some level even respectful of the specificity of that particular object, because that is what it is like. So the drawings were born from that kind of initial question. I mean, all the drawings are basically, they start out with blackboard paint as layers of raw sharp pattern, that's why they have the folds in them. And then slowly but surely I add layers and layers of materials on them. These might include found objects like sticks and twigs, or burnt wood and ash that I kind of layered on top of that soil. I chucked whole spadefuls of soil on them, and then white chalk. I always like the idea of working with white chalk on a blackboard paint, because it reminds us of this possibility of erasure. That thing can just disappear. It emerges, but momentarily, and if you touch it, it's gone. And certainly white chalk also has that application within the building industry of setting out structural lines that we can follow and build through. So, at first I wanted to draw images, but I quickly discovered that drawing is not the best way to activate these things. So they became throwing and pouring and hoping. And I don't think that these are finished. I think they're just in this state at the moment. This is where I start. That's it. And I thought, well, this is interesting. This just happened. So the whole series of drawings started that way, and they on another level, despite this kind of overt usage of chance materials, I wanted to be quite meticulous in terms of drawing that. It wasn't just a symbol, it was that particular sculpt. So to spend real time with it, to actually really look at it and get familiar with it, so that no matter whatever else happens, I know that you can show me a million times, but that I know. So there's something about that specificity, I think, that drawing allowed me to discover in the object. I work a lot with found objects. And slowly but surely attaching kind of meaning to the object, making it become, or filling it with some kind of life. This might be the best that I can hope for in this particular case. Where others have given up, I feel, artists often continue. They skip, and they look. So the works also have body prints. It's an old kind of thing of mine. The arts, sometimes some of them have 8 to 10 layers of materials, and I think they are in the process of destroying themselves. If you shake them, they fall off and whatever, but I think that is part of the nature of the thing. So there's body prints in there as well, because I always leave traces of myself in there as well. So on the one hand, while that's happening, of course, other things happen to you in your life as well, and we'll return to them as we kind of go on our journey. So if you'll join me and move into this space. The unseen presence in this exhibition is the kind of, call it this pyramid figure that is my mother. The first time I made a work about her relative disappearance is 2013, at which point I realized that she was suffering from Alzheimer's and her memory was quickly failing. So I made a work about memory back then, still in London. I performed it once. I performed it to a group of people about her, and I realized that slowly but surely I would have to deal with this disappearance. She was a major force in my life, in as much as I grew up going to art galleries with her. I was a child, basically grew up in art galleries, whether that's the Johannesburg Art Gallery. I still remember, I think it's 1981, 1980, the purpose of having run off that Janet and I were when she took me on. So I would have been 5 or something. But so slowly but surely, this problem of her disappearance, if you like, starts figurating my own thinking. And then during the COVID pandemic, she, at which point she was already starting to fall off with Alzheimer's, she unfortunately passed away from COVID, which at that point, I have to be honest, was a mercy. It was better than not seeing her in that kind of fleshy state of nothingness that she began to inhabit. But because her disappearance takes place over a number of years, it's also more difficult to process, to kind of master those. So I start thinking to myself, well, what are the artifacts or the things that kind of kept her close to me, close to the rest of us? And then strangely, I find that it's a photograph. One particular photograph of her as a child standing in my grandfather's hand, literally like this. And this is also the most meaningful memory that I have of her. And I don't just mean of her, but of growing up with this person, and that these images of her in my head as a living being person, and this image of her standing on my grandfather's hand have in some way become inseparable. They now exist as a singular. It's a thought or an idea about a person who, by all accounts, was truly a brilliant human being. And at that point in her life, the world is ahead of her. been carried forward somewhat effortlessly through her ancestors. And I think I then start imagining how one can respond to that as an artist, because this becomes the key that opens up the possibility of making a larger exhibition, not simply about her disappearance, but also about the kind of larger issues that can be drawn from that kind of experience. Because after all, I only tell the story for myself, then I could just as well have saved myself all this talk. I want other people to understand things, to feel the force of them through the thing that only an artist can do, which is to unlock the poetic, the depth of things otherwise seen but not appreciated and even understood. So at that point I realized I will make a video about it. Some of the motifs are still present within this particular installation. For example, the bird here, which I drop every minute. So every minute or so, I just froze. So that starts with my grandfather's hand perhaps, but it's adapted in this. That is a Maison Lurie. Turco bird, I bought that while I was in London. It came up in auction. It came, it said it was collected here in South Africa in 1872, roundabout, one of the great naturalist expeditions. Taken to London, kept there. It was taken out of the museum collection, and I then purchased that bird skin and brought back to South Africa around a year later. And then on this round as well, here there's a small video piece, which this was my mother's favorite dress. That was the only thing I really wanted from others. Because I remember I'd gone to the store with her. I might have been 16 or 17 at the time. She purchased it, I remember the day very well. She loved it. By the time she passes on, this dress is no longer functional. But she refuses to let it go. Because she loves it that much. It has holes. This thing is no more. And yet there it hangs until the very end of her life. There's meaning for her in this object. She hangs on to this kind of weight that holds it. Anyway, so I reanimate it, I build a large contraption, and I carry her around throughout the space where I live through the streets, and I shot the video. And then for me it's important to know, on one hand, she's liberated, becomes ghostly and apparition and floats around my feet. It's colorful. Then out of the soil, again, it's not simply a burial site. You know, people walk in and they say, oh, is this a grave? It's not. Things are never simple as that, you know. We can only be here because others were here before us. We only have meaningful knowledge of things because others have paid for that knowledge through their lives, as we are doing now. Right now, even in this particular moment, we are trying to have, at least even though it's slightly one-sided, I grant you, but a meaningful conversation about this work, this moment, this life. So it's not just that, it's also a building soil. It's also the heaps of soil that I grew up seeing in Boxburg in the 80s, the great mine dumps of South Africa. They've traveled with me throughout a number of works, and often this heap of soil comes back. It is for me the land, the hope of the thing, the desolate landscape of the East Rand. But even amongst all of that desolation, life blossomed. So that video, of course, that's the real skull. And it was shot over a period of about 10 minutes with natural light. So you really spend a lot of time with it. You'll see the light change. There's very, very slight movement. A little bit of wind comes. And again, I think on one So, you know, it's interesting to me because I kept all these diaries and I write down things in them. Now, I wonder what people will make of any one of them. Perhaps, Lord knows, I'm not so sure that they need to make so much out of them. Perhaps they're not. And it's a thing that I think that I found, or that my mother first taught me, because she also would keep diaries and we'll find her something. We find people in some way sort of in a kind of drunken revelry that is happy memories. I remember thinking about this a while ago, and I wrote this short little verse, bedwelmd, and it's an Afrikaans word, bedwelmd in buiten commissie, a sonskyn in police, jy vir my. Jy vir my, a donkrag en a wit nag, sterke my ridder, jy vir my. En tussen die jou bene, sluit hy oor die stene, my klein vriend, kyk ek word in my gebied. Copyright 1976. So I'm looking for the date of this, and that's the closest we get, and that 1976 is the year I'm born. This is where I enter the picture, so to speak, and complicate things immeasurably for my mother. But I like to think that I made things slightly better for her as well. But what's interesting is as you go through these texts, many of which she left me, I just took. I find her every now and then in small notes. Notes like these. Handfuls. Still in her handwriting. And they're everywhere in the books. So, as I am looking for one thing, I find another thing. Look at this. Small things like this. Her name, date, and darker teeth. To feel our love, we must be vulnerable to our pain. Hurt is one way for us to know how deeply we feel our pain. The great challenges of life appear to us when and only when we have everything we need to survive. Balance is not all it's cracked up to be. Numbers are believed to be a universal language that describes everything from the origin of galaxies to the swirls of milk in a cup. It makes sense that the same processes describing the visible world of nature may also be viewed as metaphors for the invisible, for the world of feelings and emotions as well. This is precisely the case in fractal mathematics. She makes a note very important. From rugged mountains, from coastlines to particles of land, of light, fractals allow us to model many of the things that we see in nature. In doing so, we are transported beyond the something, beyond something dry and sterile, beyond the world of numbers on paper, to the beauty and the mystery of seeing these numbers as a language that illustrates our world. She notes, colors and patterns change. In simulated images, we are actually seeing a powerful representation of our emotional relationship. They play out in life. The patterns that appear and then disappear represent the relationships and careers and all of the joy and sadness that come through our lives. Just as the computer images show us that balance can only exist when all of the patterns are in place to support, we can experience our greatest tests as well as accept our greatest gifts. Only when all of the pieces are in one place to do so. As symbols of our never-ending dance of opposites, give and take, hurt and heal, the patterns that appear and then disappear and then disappear represent relationships and careers and all the joy and sadness that come and go throughout our lives. All of these patterns in place to support. Only with all of them can we experience our greatest tests. And she repeats herself, as symbols for our never-ending dance of Christ. Give and take, contraction and expansion. But during, you know, initially when we planned this, I said I would come here and there would be a series of what I called lesser miracles, right? I call them lesser miracles because they're human and because it's a simple miracle of just being alive, being in the space, doing things and so on. Then of course, what happens is when was it, on the 12th of June, I believe, the Sunday evening, I walk into my garage in search of my keys, and I end up falling over one of my own sculptures, and I cut my knee so badly that I have to be rushed to ER. But at some point during all of that, there's two things that are interesting. So the first is, that first, well, what's the second week of the show, is out. I can't do a thing. The leg is so bad, it's just out. Okay, so there goes the plan. And I still have the stitches, it's over 40 stitches, and it's inside and they have to take it out or whatever. And I'm very thankful that that I don't have serious damage or long-term damage, but it does mean that there's no lesser miracles happening at least there for about 10 days of the show. So I felt it was important to kind of also weave in a performative moment. I wouldn't have minded if you didn't put up at some point. I think at the last moment, yeah, no. Yeah, sure. But the other thing that's also interesting is there's at least one moment while I'm sitting there that evening and waiting to go to ER because I cut a lot of veins and so I'm bleeding profusely and it's a disaster, where the poetic possibility of dying whilst I'm having a show about death strikes me.
And the cause being your own sculpture.
Yeah, sculpture. And I was lucky someone was there and they could bring me a belt and we tied it up and there was four veins kind of off. And so, you know, checking out was a real possibility there. I think the doctor had a bigger fright than I did. They spent over 2.5 hours just stitching everything back together. So, but then there's also that kind of moment where you realize, well, as interesting an aside as that might be in South African art history, you have to think about what you're building and what you're leaving and so on. Of course, that's also a generational thing. So you have to think the greatest thing that you might give to this world is not this grand sense of poetry or anything else, but the fact that you might have to look after your child until they are ready to speak. You know, so,
yes. My interruption was going to be when you were talking about the drawings as not only as sites of decay but as building sites. I found it very interesting that you were talking about white chalk and how it can be easily erased and non-erased, and it occurred to me that white chalk is also what's used to demarcate bodies.
Exactly.
And
yeah,
I really, now I see the drawings a little bit differently with that thought in mind.
Yeah, exactly, it's quite a bit wrong. And then simultaneously they also use it for the building lines. It's a theory.
So it's about plotting this way forward, knowing it can be erased at any time, yeah, which is really a bigger metaphor for what you're all doing daily.
Yeah, and I think it's meaningful to me that you see the work that way, that someone else reads the work that way, because I mean certainly when I started with this series of work, which is now many years, in the making. I think one of the concerns is that if your work is that highly personal and you can't actually reach an audience, you've got a problem. You must be able to take something highly personal and work it into a material form that retains something of that free and rebellious spirit to keep on communicating beyond your limited expectations of it. You know. I think it's always difficult for artists.
I think you really achieved that.
I'm very pleased with that.
It's not just through the show, but with what you're talking about today. I actually felt that I wish I'd brought my parents to this.
It's nice. Yeah, I mean, it was very, this last little bit really moved me, because this that's my mother's writing. Yeah, that's all her own notes and stuff. So it kind of really moved me, because I didn't have it before the show. I didn't take the title from her. This is something that now comes, you know, and I mean, I had the book, Drawing Handbook, but then somehow during the last 3 weeks or whatever, my little boy is scrounging about the house and he finds these notes and he gives them to me. And then he finds this, and I asked him where he got it, and he said, no, it was in the book and it fell out earlier. And it really touched me deeply the moment that I realized that this exact phrase that's the title of the show is in these notes. And really, yeah, it's really shook me. So there's a sense of some kind of
continuity. It's eerie.
It's eerie, and even just like this thing of me falling during the time of the show, and I'm nearly checking out, you know, there's a weight to the thing, and I think maybe we, you know, I'm a great believer in chance, but I also think I'm a believer in chance, but not in coincidence. At least not in human effect. But so there's a bigger gap there. Any other questions or comments? Yes, please.
I was watching when you were reading the soul as we drowned, the brushed.
Yeah.
Sometimes of keeping the shoulder. And you're very close to that soul.
Now
it's just another interesting metaphor that touching you.
But people ask if they ever do actually touch, but the feeling was always that they need to retain that possibility that they might collide. They don't actually have to. It was very nice. I wrote to a friend of mine who lives in the US, and I showed him some images of the work, and he's actually Nigerian, but he lives there now. And he loved it immediately, because he said it felt to him like, as Africans, we're always just dodging the bullets. We're always just missing them. You know, if you're lucky, you can dodge them. And I thought that was quite insightful, because it does feel to me like that. You know, a lot of the times, I just missed an accident. You know, on my way here this morning, there's an accident just as I drive up, two taxis. Clearly someone's passed away there, and then as I'm on the highway, there's another accident. It feels to me like we're continuously coming back close to death, though. And it's really, really
Thank you.
Yes.
That dissolves the body, yes. That then goes yes. back to this kind of dancing power and the shroud like. Really enjoy that.
Thank you. That's very nice. The dancing part is very nice. No, I do. I really appreciate the dancing part. I think the shroud like feeling was interesting. What interests me about this is, I don't particularly love that image there, but if you take a photograph, it becomes something else. It's really strange, yeah. I think you see it from a distance. So a lot of the times for me to actually see the works also require other people looking at it. Because I would say, oh, I can see that it's so clearly. And then other people say, yeah. This is not so clear. This is a good thing, that's why you have other people around. Sorry, thank you.
When you stood there, I thought it was planned from the start, that sort of mixes or connects just the width of your neck.
Yeah.
It seemed that you guys had just over your shoulders.
Yeah.
So it worked 100%. And I think if you had the same direction, they would not come opposite the way they are now. So it's actually better the way they are.
Yeah, it just
strikes me. As metaphor and as simplistic, you know, as the way you put it, you know, death and golden, this is so clear. And it's wonderfully concise. And you standing in the room with me, making it part of your oeuvre, performance, that worked really well.
Well, it was definitely planned that way, and I always knew there has to be space for that body somewhere. You know. And I don't think it helps to try and make this too dramatic. So sort of kind of still figure there that's exactly kind of space that's required. So, you know. Any other questions or comments?
Yeah. Something that sort of stood out for me was some mentioning trauma and some taking questions. And I think you made a comment around perseverance, which sort of triggered me a little bit. Because when you were standing as part of the performance, like the metaphor around surviving sort of this process of life of building and dying. But also going through trauma relating to that. And perseverance of the human spirit, it's how you take the shots in your personal capacity, in your psyche, in order to survive. So this idea of survival, but it's really about your individual ability to stand against that, to take the hit, but also come out stronger.
I think we have to always, you know, those of us who are lucky enough to have that level of agency, we must use it most. I mean, that's a wholly ethical kind of point, but if you're strong enough to take the shots, you have a big responsibility, I think. Because I do always think to myself, there are people something behind, you know, like I told you about the origin of the skull, you know, there's no one, there's no connection, and that having been severed, it's I had this discussion with my girlfriend this morning. She, and it's very morbid now, but I mean, her cousin was murdered in Cape Town, and the only reason why they brought it to her is because their family, they're Indian, but their family had the resources to get private detectives on the case within 2 hours of her disappearing. And they sorted this out right there and then. So, there is that level, and this is the big thing that kind of worries me actually about South Africa, is that you know, the things that the state are supposed to be doing and building and so on aren't happening. And I think all of us feel this maybe particularly strongly now with the power outage and all of that as well. But there's that sense of building that I think was very powerful for a while. We're willing to take the shots. I wonder what happens when we get tired of that. You know, or as I explained, I think it's in the press release, there's this gigantic reservoir or repository of trauma that lives in this country. And I wonder what happens if that thing just goes. If it gets to a point where it's happening. Maybe it's already doing it. Maybe it's woven into our existence already. You know, maybe it's part of us already. Maybe we just live it now and it affects how our heads in ways that we can't even rationally imagine.
Collective consciousness.
Yeah, that is here. It's already exploded. We live it. We just don't know it, you know. But I know that, you know, as much as I complain about those kind of things, for example, you know, and it has to be said, I mean, I'm privileged. I have a job at university, I have a safe home, and all of those kind of things. Hello. I realize that there's a deep responsibility on that level, and that's why I said it was an ethical point, rather, is that, you know, there's tons of people out there who don't have that clip of access, and so I wonder what happens to them, you know.
I just want to say, in spite of the trauma and the darkness, you also remind us of thinking of the small things, the little writings, the beautiful thoughts, and it's, you know, very sensitive.
I think that's nice because one of the things that happened, kind of, that I wasn't initially in favor of, but actually just played out that way, is that there's a sense of lightness that I think is physically present in the show. And that is the vital kind of counterpart against that kind of being dragged under this negative thing and so on. Because as an artist, you can't really make good work if you just feel pessimistic and negative. You have to feel hopeful. You can build and you can continue and you can do all. So it's nice for me because even though I would like the projection to be crystal clear and so on, I actually like the fact that now it's suffused with light on that. I just, it feels so much light. It feels like the force of life is there and it's making its presence felt. So it's a long time.
Well, I think that's why memory is so important as a balancing sort of idea.
Mm.
The memories, you know, we speak about trauma, which is essentially a collection of bad memories, but what you were saying is the small memories, the memories and the things that are unlocked by reading your mother's writing, you know, these things are so overwhelmingly positive.
Yeah.
One small, super positive memory can really eclipse a much bigger trauma quite easily, so I think,
no, I think that's really nice.
Memory is something that's so intrinsically clear.
Yeah, I think for me that's the kind of thing that reminds me of my own task in this, if you like, or the poetics of the thing and something moving forward is all of these little things, the meaning of them, how they carry us forward. So, yeah.
Guys, we are going to bring it to an end, but we are going to hang around for a little bit of time. Much to Johannes' dismay, I'm going to say we can give him a round of applause.